The Illuminati Formula to Create an Undetectable Total Mind Control Slave by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 12. Table of Contents for Podcasts 12-24, about the second half of this book. Chapter 6 Science, the Use of Electricity, and Electronics. A for Torture. B for Memory Deletion. C for Implanting Thoughts. D. Electronic Communication and Control. Chapter 7 Engineering and Structuring of an MPD System. A. Structuring of MPD Worlds. B. The Creation of Roles. C. Building in Layered Defenses. D. Building Backup Systems. Chapter 8 Body Manipulation and Programming. A. Scarring the Brainstem. B. Split Brain Work. C. Medical Technologies. D. Histamines. E. The Use of Body Programs. Chapter 9 Mind Manipulation by Psychological Programming Methods, Behavior Modification, Psychological Motivation, and Neurolinguistic Programming, NLP. A. Observing a satanic family conditioning their children. B. Behavior Modification, Obedience Training. C. Isolation. D. Repetition. E. Psychological Motivators, Pride/Need/Wants. F. Neurolinguistic Programming. G. The Inversion of Pain and Pleasure. Chapter 10 AC Spiritual Control Techniques, Possession, Trances, etc. A. Using Spiritual Principles Against a Person. B. How the Monarch Program Miniaturizes What is Done on a Large Scale. C. Dehumanization. D. Fear. E. The Use of Guilt, Shame, Ridicule, and Anger. F. Teaching that the Master is God. G. Portals, Focal Points. H. Vows and Oaths. I. The Use of Demon Possession, Layering in, etc. J. The Use of Angel Altars. K. The Misuse of Scripture. L. Theta Programming. Chapter 11 Internal Controls. A. Teaching Occult Philosophies and Ideologies. B. Internal Computers. C. Internal Hierarchies. Chapter 12 External Controls. A. Monitoring, Asset Control. B. The Art of Blackmail. C. Bribes. D. The Control of the Milieu. E. Bonding and Twinning. F. Peer Pressure. Chapter 6, Science, the Use of Electronics, and Electricity. Another basic component of the Monarch program is lots of electroshock. Stun guns, staffs with hidden electric cattle prods, and cattle prods are frequently used on the slaves. Electroshock is used to create the dissociation from trauma during the programming, and later it is used to remove memories after the slave has carried out a mission, or to instill fear and obedience in a reluctant slave. Slaves generally carry horrible body memories of excruciating electroshock tortures to their entire bodies. As the slaves begin a therapeutic deprogramming process, they will recover these horrible memories, not to mention many other painful memories. A slave often shows electroshock marks on their feet, or back, or buttock or legs after they have been used. An owner of a slave will ordinarily carry a stun gun. This is perhaps a 120,000 DC volt stun gun to erase and compartmentalize memories, but some of the stun guns go up to 200,000 volts DC to erase the memory of his slave. They will apply their stun guns to the base of the skull. After giving programming instructions, they will usually give a high voltage shock to the base of the skull to embed the instructions deep in the subconscious. They often use hypnotic cues along with the shock. For instance, they will tell the slave they are now going over the rainbow, and that when the sun goes down they will forget everything, before they shock the body. Illustrations photos printed in a magazine in the fall of 1981 show electric prod marks on the necks of these two slaves who were used for porn. The shock destroys and scrambles the memory which is still stored in the short-term memory section of the brain. They must shock the person within 24 hours, to ensure that the short-term memory doesn't get into long-term memory as a coherent memory. This means that if a slave is being used daily, they get electroshocked daily. Types of devices used by handlers, A cylindrical type cattle prod with 0.75 between the contact points is used externally and internally. This is manufactured by Hotshot Products Incorporated, Savage, Minnesota, 55378. Model B12. They have a red or black rubber handle with an overall length of 12. The low voltage is between 10,000 to 15,000 volts. The medium voltage is 12,000 to 20,000 volts. A bruise on the buttocks will be black and blue spots about 1.5 diameter each. A handheld wand type shock prod which has 2.75 between its contact points. It uses a rechargeable battery pack. The prod, wand, is 2.5 long, and unwieldy to handle. Various farm supply companies, livestock equipment, sell this. The medium voltage is 12,000 to 20,000. A stun gun which has exactly 2 between the contacts with a 9-volt battery. This stun gun was created for law enforcement, and is generally regarded as the best device for dropping a victim or for inducing hypnosis, or setting in a hypnotic program. Its high voltage is 35,000 to 120,000 volts. It is a lightweight, 12 ounces, compact device, 7 inches by 2 inches by 1 inches. This device will leave deep red dot, holes, scars and cancerous moles. The victim will develop moles from the repeated use of this device. The muscled areas of the victim are preferred. For instance, the muscled area just below the shoulder blade. Farrell Instrument Co., of Grand Island, NE makes a cattle prod with an adjustable voltage control. Their long-distance wireless shocker called Personal Shocker can shoot a shock about 75 indoors and 300 feet outdoors. The control box is handheld, and the receiver is a leather case. The shock can be adjusted from 9 to 800 volts, current is 5 milliamperes, and it lasts 1 to 2 milliseconds. This personal shocker was manufactured to be used on people. An electronic firm in Tahunga, CA, makes a shock box used in programming. An electronic bark collar is used to train Illuminati and other monarch slaves in silence and obedience. On other occasions, fancy gem-studded collars and leather collars are fitted around the necks of female slaves for sex with wolves and fierce dogs, who bite these neck collars when they mount. Many of the slaves have experienced these various collars for obedience, silence, and bestiality. In trying to track down who makes the larger electroshock machines, especially the computer-guided ones, we only got started investigating. ConMed, 315-797-8375, makes medical electrodes for portable monitoring units. Century Medical Products, at 17171 Murphy, Irvine, California, 92714, 714-250-0233, makes skin-mounted conductive medical electrodes for tense unit machines. In Vivo Metric, in Healdsburg, California, also makes silver chloride electrodes for placement on human skin. Electrocapinter, produces beg placement systems. Unipatch Medical Products, 1313 T Grant Boulevard. W. Wabasha, Minnesota, makes all types of electrodes and some of theirs go onto machines for shocking people. Classic Medical Products, 582TW19246, Apollo Drive, Muskego, Wisconsin, make electrodes for diagnostic and shock purposes. Arndt Automation and Association, Inc., 17770, Liberty Lane, New Berlin, Wisconsin, make electrodes for ECG and EKG machines. And a Colorado company named Biomedical at Evergreen Co. makes medical electrodes. When a slave is taken to an impromptu programming site, a hypnotic drug is injected into them for a quick induction while a metal band is put around their head and a current of 100000 volts will be run through for say 5 seconds into their heads. This will cause the body to shake, the eyes to close, sweat to pour out of the body, etc. The hands are tied down with restraints. Sometimes the mouth is gagged so that the tongue doesn't protrude. After embedding the hypnotic commands deep into the mind, the programmers might adjust the automatic timer on the equipment and give the victim another blast of voltage for 10 seconds. The person's body will shake and quiver for a while after this. They may dribble spit. Finally, the person will be brought out of their hypnotic trance, instructed not to remember anything, to feel happy and sent on their way. This entire programming session can last 15 minutes. Programming sites like this can be the back of a van, a back room in a restaurant, or any other place that the equipment can be set up at. This is why a slave, who has been used recently, may hobble a little, or when they get memories feel a tight headband around their head along with awful headaches and flashes of light. The memory will feel like a robotic state to the slave. Here is a drawing that one slave made of the electric headband used to program an altar. The X-rays below were used with the victim's permission. Mind control implant in the nasal cavity. The slave handler will also carry a black or gray spiral book with all their own slaves' access codes, triggers, cryptic keys and programs. All this will fit into a briefcase. A working knowledge of hypnosis is helpful to understand how to deal with the slave in certain instances. Because the slave is under the most powerful combinations of mind control and is so divided against his or her own self, it is almost impossible to have many problems with the slave if the handler does what he is supposed to do. However, some handlers get drunk or loan the slave to inexperienced people, etc. And problems do develop. Of course, the slaves always end up taking the blame for everything that goes wrong. If the slave gets out of hand, because the handler doesn't know what he is doing, a stun gun comes in handy to control the mismanaged slave. In other words, a briefcase with the programming book and stun gun are basically all that is needed to control a monarch slave for the rest of his or her life. Some of these stun guns are only a few inches long and look like boxes. Other stun guns are embedded in staffs. The canes and the staffs that Satanists carry around, like Michael Aquino, in public in fact, are actually stun guns to control their slaves. Electrodes implanted in the person's skull when a child in the 1940s. Transmitting implant in the cortex. Implants enlarged from 7 mm and 11 mm. The Queen Mother's staff of the Illuminati has an electric stun gun hidden in it. Children in daycare centers are reporting small boxes with wires that electroshock them during programming. An example is given in Volume 1, of how the Illuminati bloodlines connect to research about electric shocks to control people. For example, David V. Reynolds' research, who wrote, Neuroelectric Research, Electroneuroprosthesis, Electroanesthesia, and Nonconvulsive Electrotherapy. Another way of using electricity for torture is to use directed energy, a new technology, on men's genitals. With skillful use of directed energy, they can simulate a rape of a man or woman. Artificial sodomy via directed energy was first tested in male prisons. Elf waves will place thoughts into the men's mind as the directed energy make them feel sodomized. Microwaves for programming. On August 22, 1989, Philip L. Stocklin, P.O. Box 2111, Satellite Beach, Florida took out a patent which is patent number 4,858,612, which is a device that can be placed in the auditory cortex of the brain. This device allows the following process: someone speaks into a microphone, the microphone then has its sounds coded into microwave, which are sent to the receiver in the brain, and the receiver device will transform the microwaves back so that the person's mind hears the original sounds. In other words, a person with this device in their head will hear whatever the programmers send via microwave signals. Various types of non-lethal weapons have been created and are now being used. Directed energy can be used to sculpt clouds. Elf waves can be used to place thoughts in people's minds without using implants. In 1991, a paper trail began to appear when the CIA connected. U.S. Government Global Strategy Council came out with a paper entitled, Non-Lethality, Development of a National Policy and Employing Non-Lethal Means in a New Strategic Era. Their paper was prepared by Janet Morris. The U.S. Air Force School of Aerospace Medicine, Brooks Air Force Base, TX put out a report Yosefam TR-8730 entitled Behavioral Response of Rats Exposed to High-Power Microwave Radiation. High power, Ultra-short pulse width emitters of microwaves were used to alter the thinking in rats. The report refers to two other reports, one by T. Wheeler, E.T. Al. Retrograde amnesia in rats produced by electron beam exposure, entitled Yosefam TR83-3, February 83. The other report is by R. Bermant, Classical Conditioning of Microwave-Induced Hyperthermia in Rats. Radio Psi 14, SIXS 201-207, 1979. This is a clear paper trail that military research has gone on to control the brain via microwaves. Another institution in Texas, the Texas Department of Criminal Justice TDCJID, has been putting high-tech listening implants into the ear canal behind the eardrum, which lets them monitor what the ear is hearing, a great way to spy. This is according to an implant victim who, with medical help, discovered his implant. The Walter Reed Army Institute of Research, RARE, discovered that pulsed microwave audiograms, also called analogs of the sounds of spoken words, could be transmitted to a target, and the effect on victim would be to hear voices in their head. The next 11 pages are patent number 4,858,612. After this, we'll reveal the numerous mind control capabilities of ELF microwave tech. The next pages may present the reader with some minor difficulties in reading, because with some words it was not possible to process them, because of poor printing. So some words are lost, and this can make certain sentences appear strange. Hearing device. Background of the invention. One field. This invention relates to devices for aiding at hearing in mammals. The invention is based upon the perception at sounds which is experienced in the brain when the brain is subjected to certain microwave radiation signals. 2. Description. In prior art hearing devices for human beings, it is well known to amplify sounds to be heard and to apply the amplified sound signal to the ear at the person wearing the hearing aid. Hearing devices of this type are, however, limited to hearing dysfunctions where there is no damage to the auditory nerve or to the auditory cortex. In the prior art, if there is damage to the auditory cortex or the auditory nerve, it cannot be corrected by the use of a hearing aid. During World War II, individuals in the radiation path of certain radar installations observed clicks and buzzing sounds in response to the microwave radiation. It was through this early observation that it became known to the art that microwaves could cause a direct perception at sound within a human brain. These buzzing or clicking sounds, however, were not meaningful and were not perception of sounds which could otherwise be heard by the receiver. This type of microwave radiation was not representative of any intelligible sound to be perceived. In such radar installations, there was never a sound which was generated which resulted in subsequent generation of microwave signals representative of that sound. Since the early perception of buzzing and clicking, further research has been conducted into the microwave reaction of the brain. In an article entitled Possible Microwave Mechanisms of the Mammalian Nervous System by Philip L. Stocklin and Brain F. Stocklin, published in the TIT Journal of Life Sciences. Tower International Technomedical Institute. Incorporated P.O. Box 4594, Philadelphia, PA, 1979, there is disclosed a hypothesis that the mammalian brain generates and uses electromagnetic waves in the lower microwave frequency region as an integral part of the functioning of the central and peripheral nervous systems. This analysis is based primarily upon the potential energy of a protein integral in the neural membrane. In an article by W.B.'s entitled Low-Power Radio Frequency and Microwave Effects on Human Electroencephalogram and Behavior, Physiol. Chemistry Physical 10. 387, 1978, it is reported that there are significant effects upon the alert human EEG during radiation by low-intensity microwave electromagnetic energy. Bees observed significant repeatable EEG effects TARA subject during radiation at specific microwave frequencies. Summary of the invention. Results at theoretical analysis of the physics of brain tissue and the brain and skull cavity, combined with experimentally determined electromagnetic properties at mammalian brain tissue, indicate the physical necessity for the existence of electromagnetic standing waves called modes in the living mammalian brain. The made characteristics RNI be determined by two geometric properties at the brain. These are the cephalic index at the brain, its shape in prolate spheroidal coordinates, and the semifocal distance of the brain, a measure of its size. It was concluded that estimation of brain cephalic index and semifocal distance using external skull measurements on subjects permits estimation of the subject's characteristic mode frequencies, which in turn will permit a mode-by-mode treatment at the data to simulate hearing. This invention provides for sound perception by individuals who have impaired hearing resulting tram ear damage, auditory nerve damage, and damage to the auditory cortex. This invention provides for simulation of microwave radiation which is normally produced by the auditory cortex. The simulated brain waves are introduced into the region at the auditory cortex and provide for perceived sounds on the part at the subject. Brief description of the drawings. Figure 1 shows the acoustic filter bank and mode control matrix portions of the hearing device at this invention. Figure 2 shows the microwave generation and antenna portion of the hearing device of this invention. Figure 3 shows a typical voltage divider network which may be used to provide mode partition. Figure 4 shows another voltage divider device which may be used to provide mode partition. Figure 5 shows a voltage divider to be used as a mode partition wherein each of the resistors is variable in order to provide adjustment of the voltage outputs. Figure 6 shows a modified hearing device which includes adjustable mode partitioning, and which is used to provide initial calibration of the hearing device. Figure 7 shows a group of variable oscillators and variable gain controls which are used to determine hearing characteristics of a particular subject. Figure 8 shows a top view of a human skull showing the lateral dimension. Figure 9 shows the relationship of the prolate spherical coordinate system to the Cartesian system. Figure 10 shows a side view of a skull showing the medial plane of the head. Figure 11 shows a plot of the transverse electric field amplitude versus primary mode number M. Figure 12 shows a left side view of the brain and auditory cortex. Figure 13 shows the total modal field versus angle for source location. For the figures referred to further down the article, see the pictures above. Note: a technical description of a hearing device is relocated at the end of this podcast 12. In 1989, James C. Lynn wrote Electromagnetic Interaction with Biological Systems, which deals with transmitting ideas and words via electromagnetic waves. Briefcases, stereo speakers, and boxes are some of the disguises that the CIA has been caught using to hide their ELF microwave emitters that plant thoughts in people. One victim who spent time talking to Fritz Springmeier reported how they had repeatedly tried to trick him into going to free hotel rooms and other traps, where they tried to bombard his head with the idea that he should sell drugs. He cleverly dismantled their devices which they hid in the ceilings and other locations in these rooms to protect himself from the thoughts they were trying repeatedly to beam into his head. He was on the run as a fugitive to protect his mind. Naval intelligence and other groups have conducted research into extra-low-frequency, ELF, waves upon the human body and mind. Some of the many things that can be done to the human body and mind with ELF waves include: A. Put a person to sleep. B. Make a person tired or depressed. C. Create a feeling of fear in a person. D. Create a zombie state. E. Create a violent state. F. Create a state of being sexually aggressive. G. Change cellular chemistry. H. Change hormone levels. I. Inhibit or enhance messenger RNA synthesis and processes. J. Control the DNA transaction process. K. Control biological spin and proton coupling constants in DNA, RNA, and RNA transferases. Unfortunately for us humans, ELF waves can penetrate almost anything. The U.S. military has built a ground wave emergency network, GWEN, all over the U.S. with several hundred 300 500 Gwen towers that broadcast a very low frequency wave, VLF, for mind control of the American public. A single Gwen tower can broadcast up to 300 miles in a 3,600 circle. Plus 8 secret powerful ELF transmitters have been established and 3 of them operate on the West Coast. Prozac and slaves and microwave towers. Some of the monarch slaves are receiving Prozac. Prozac, fluoxetine hydrochloride a serotonin reuptake inhibitor, is dangerous for everyone. Prozac is now the second most used drug in the world. Three examples of the ongoing nightmare now happening worldwide. September 14, 1989 Joseph Wesbecker on Prozac went crazy and got a gun and opened fire in the Standard Gravure building in Louisville, killing 8 and wounding 12 others before killing himself. 20 suits against Eli Lilly were filed by victim in this case. July 1990 Rhonda Halla of Shirley, New York filed a $150 million suit against Eli Lilly charging that Prozac had driven her repeatedly to attempt suicide. August 1990 CCHR called on Congress to ban Prozac and three widows in Louisville, KT filed $50 million lawsuits each, charging that a man on Prozac had been driven insane to kill by the Prozac and had killed their husbands. Two other lawsuits were filed in this time period, one from Indianapolis, and one from Chicago from people driven to attempt suicide by Prozac. Certain brain activities trigger people on Prozac to become homicidal or suicidal. Thanks to research by Illuminati-controlled companies, the network knows exactly how to use ELF waves vectored on a particular person by three separate towers to stimulate the Prozac-controlled brain to murder. This is being used to increase acts of anarchy and violence in order to help ensure anti-gun legislation. If a slave doesn't comply or needs to be thrown from the freedom train, they can become a usable statistic. Simply trigger them to murder and then watch the police gun them down. The NWO gains one more statistic and another case to scare the public into accepting gun control. The use of waves and electricity to implant thoughts. The programmers are always trying to outdo what they've done before. They are not satisfied with the old recipes for scrambled brains, they keep inventing and refining new methods. Anything and everything within their grasp has been tried. They have found that ELF and VLF electromagnetic waves can be used to control people's thoughts. Harmonics and sound waves are used to manipulate the RNA covering of neuron pathways to the subconscious. Harmonic generators, codenamed Etherwave, are able to embed detailed commands which are linked to audible triggers. This is one of the standard features of the Monarch program. It allows the slaves to be controlled by trigger words which make no sense or seem to carry no negative connotation to outside listeners. For instance, the words, "Mr. Postman, wait and see," a marionette command, might set off an access sequence so that a slave living away from its master goes to its master, also called a handler. The use of harmonics has taken away much of the work of the big programmers. Now harmonic machines can implant the programming and codes that the programmers put in. It's quicker and perhaps more efficient, although the lesser cult groups have to get by with the older methods. And the Illuminati still have many excellent programmers in full-time and part-time use. According to an eyewitness, their top programmers are far beyond their 1950-60 predecessors like Mengele. There are four types of brain waves: alpha, beta, delta, and theta. The four basic models of monarch slaves have the same names as these four types of brain waves. High-level Illuminati models may have programming that includes all of these types. According to one ex-government source, the CIA has been labeling their harmonic-created total mind-controlled slaves by the following. Bravo 2 series models are men programmed to run the beast computers. Delta series are models for espionage and assassination. Juliet series are sexual mind-controlled slaves. Kilo 5 series is military espionage. Michael 1 series slaves are CIA agents under total mind control. Operation Green Star was the mind control project to create UFO abduction scenarios. Much of the high-level programming in the 1980s and 1990s is no longer done with human programmers, but is done via programmed machines using drugs, electricity, and harmonics. Tracking and ID. Implants. A great deal has come out in a whole number of Christian books, as well as secular books about the microchips that are being implanted in both people and animals. These microchips will do many things, depending upon which type of microchip they are, however, Some of these microchips emit coded signals which allow satellites with computers to track the exact location of the person or animal carrying the chip. Obviously, a mind-controlled slave is not going to have the freedom to reject a chip like this. This gives the owner a method for tracking the slave should they ever escape to their exact location. Many of the slaves, CIA agents, and military men have these implants already. Many Desert Shield troops, to make sure they weren't lost in the desert, were required to get the tracking implants. Some counties are making it mandatory for pets to get tracking implants. Monitoring implants. As I write this, I have the report an 8-channel micro-powered PAM/FM biomedical telemetry system written by the Space Biology Lab/Brain Research Institute of the UCLA Center for Health Sciences, of Los Angeles, California, 90024. What they are reporting on is an implant which will electronically report back what is going on with a person's body to whoever is monitoring the person. Their biotelemeter consists of a signal conditioner, S, multiplexer, for multi-channel systems, and a transmitter. The entire size of the implant is 6.35 centimeters by 0.97 centimeters thick. EEG monitoring is being done of free-swimming divers by implants. A frequency of 2,300 Hz was used on the first underwater monitoring devices. Communication implants. First, we will give an overview of the subject and then we will cover the details of how the technology works. In the Bible it predicts that in the end of church age that the rulers of the world these have one mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast Rev 17:13. Robert Mueller, a member of the Illuminati, and former Assistant Secretary General of the UN, who has been involved in setting up a peace university in Costa Rica, said in a symposium toward a global brain, "Our next evolutionary step, November 9 to 11, 1984, we are beginning to link together to form one world, minds and souls. Let go of our own beliefs, crap stuff. We stand now at the threshold of the first spiritualization of humanity. The goal of having a single world mind is being advocated by people tied to the Illuminati and the New Age movement they have created. In the New Age book Gods of Aquarius, the author advocates, the only viable solution is to link the brains of all men into one giant super brain. It has been the entire species that have been developing and it must be linked into one super being. A synthesis of human minds in a world brain." Hollywood put out a movie in 1970 called Colossus. The Forbidden Project, which shows how the ultimate computer will dominate the minds of men. Unfortunately, the Illuminati now have the capability via their fronts to implant transmitters that will communicate messages to the human brain that are received via computers. The ability to literally have a single world brain is within the grasp of the elite. They must now simply figure out methods to accomplish it. All this New Age talk by world leaders like Robert Mueller about a single world mind is not hot air. Unfortunately, the technology is here already. Will humanity stop the secret elite, or will humanity continue to slide into deeper slavery? CIA programmer and researcher Professor Delgado wrote in Physical Control of the Mind in 1969 that brain transmitters can remain in a person's head for life. The energy to activate the brain transmitter is transmitted by way of radio frequencies. The radio frequencies used to transmit to brain implants are usually from 15 to 35 kHz. Radio frequency analyzing computers hooked up to computers have charted the radio frequencies being used to transmit to victims with implants. See Mediaico Investigating Reporting Group. Brain transmitters, what they are and how they are used. 1993. PG 8. The use by handlers of frequency shift signals, which is a special way of modulating through a given spectrum of frequencies, has been observed and recorded. Some of the first brain transmitters looked like bullets and were placed into the victim's brain via the nose. In the late 1960s, some of the transmitters were simply swallowed, or carried externally by the victim. Small wires embedded behind the ears are one of the implants. Sometimes implants are placed within the pain and pleasure center of the brain, which allows the handler to manipulate what feels great or what feels painful. The intelligence agencies have given their implants a whole variety of names. Some of these names for brain implants are EDOM Electronic Dissolution of Memory, EEOM Electronic Enhancement of Memory, ESB Electronic Stimulation of the Brain, RHIC Radio Hypnotic Intracerebral Control. Terms that accompany these techniques include PRAMA Personal Radio and Electromagnetic Frequency Allocation. This is an individual's personal frequency which is scanned by a handheld device, such as a reading wand. Prime Freak. This is the primary frequency of an individual, which the intelligence agencies will obtain and then manipulate to control an individual. Vital Human Brain Frequency. This is a frequency that is vital for humans, the 800 MHz band, which is manipulated for mass mind control. In 1978, Samuel Chavkin warned in his book The Mind Stealers, with the increasing sophistication and miniaturization of electronics, it may be possible to compress the necessary circuitry for a small computer into a chip that is implantable subcutaneously. In this way, the new self-contained instrument could be devised, capable of receiving, analyzing, and sending back information to the brain, establishing artificial links between unrelated cerebral areas, functional feedbacks, and programs of stimulations contingent on the appearance of predetermined wave patterns. Since Chavkin wrote this in 1978, the network has come a long way on miniaturization and sophistication of their implants. One of the most important end times communication systems of the Illuminati and their intelligence agencies is their Alex system. This will operate on several levels. The electronic end of the Alex system, which stands for Amalgamated Logarithmic Encrypted Transmission, Alex, is a method for encrypting electronic transmissions so that a computer which could decode 5 trillion codes a second would take 2,000 years to decipher one of these transmissions. In other words, when the Alex system is operating, it cannot be decoded. The Alex system has 700 billion trillion codes. Yes, the intelligence agencies and Illuminati have really outdone themselves with overkill on this one. By the way, this is very ultra secret. The Alex system intersects with the Monarch Mind Control programming. The Alex, also called Alexis, is part of the tracking and Antichrist callback programming. Outside computers are able to interconnect with the Monarch Mind Control slave and call them back for Antichrist activities. In other words, the Council of Nine of the Illuminati has placed an altar by the name of Alex or a similar name in high-level slaves, and they have either via implants or some other type of programming made these slaves available for programming via electronic communications that tie in with their Alex computers. Fritz Springmeier touched on this Antichrist programming in his Chapter 3 Mind Control monograph in 1992, when he mentioned imperial conditioning. Actually, imperial and emperor programming are programs that work in conjunction with the Alex system. All the police in this nation are to have their communications encrypted by Christmas, 1995, in time for the start of the most intense period of anarchy. The concentration camps, FEMA, FDIC, and all the rest of the acronym monsters are switching over to the secret operational frequencies, which this paragraph will now provide you. This will be 912 MHz to 954 MHz using either or both the Alex or General Dynamic scrambles. Motorola is providing the hardware. In other words, when the most intense period of anarchy and arrests begins, the New World Order, Big Brother, will have electronic transmission capabilities which will be totally secret. Even police transmissions which can be listened to now by the bad guys will no longer be receivable. The Illuminati have been saving their best technology for use during their takeover in the next few years. Implants within slaves are being used to communicate such thoughts as actual samples of things sent. A. Don't murder your family. B. The government is to blame, don't murder the president. C. You cannot get legal redress for what has been done to you by the government. D. It is not hopeless to fight us. E. You want to have sex with the opposite sex. F. You want to not deal in drugs. G. You want to protect your country by being loyal to the CIA. Since the early 1960s, the intelligence agencies have been putting two-way radio communication implants into victims. This is called telemetry or remote control. The radio wave enters the implant transmits it to the brain, and the brain's reaction is then picked up and relayed back to a computer which decodes what the brain waves show the brain was thinking. These implants in the early 60s were half the size of a cigarette filter. A few of victims have managed to escape the control of the system and get X-ray pictures of the implants and then have them removed. One victim in this Portland area has tried for years to find a legitimate surgeon to remove the implant. Liquid crystals are said by some to be used. It is said that the liquid crystals are implanted to function as transmitters. Others say that the liquid crystals were tried and were lethal. Accessories. It was discovered that if a strobe is flashed into the eyes at 10 cycles per second or 10 hertz, the brain will retune itself to that frequency. The brain will downshift from a beta state of consciousness down to an alpha or below. The entire cortex is influenced by the strobe light. Actually, this was just a rediscovery of what some of the ancients had discovered. Flashing lights have been used by people to go into altered states for a long time. Ptolemy, the famous ancient Greek astronomer, built a wheel that would flash sunlight, and people would stare at this contraption and go into an altered state. As with many inventions, they can be used for good or bad. The following machines are things that anyone can purchase, just like a stun gun or a cattle prod. An array of mind-altering electronic devices have been created over the last few decades. Personal light and sound machines that alter the brain's consciousness that were once $60,000 are now a few hundred. They have goggles that fit over a person's eyes. The synchro energizer, which requires a trained operator to run its control panel, is a machine to electronically alter the brain's consciousness with a sound and light show. 9 lights work via the goggles to give a light show to alter the brain's wave pattern. It is sold by Synchrotech of Cleveland via Synco Energize on Broadway, New York. An operator can start the Synchro Energizer at the brain's high beta waves and then takes the wave pattern downward through the alpha, and then to the theta and sometimes into the delta, the sleep state. There are smaller machines designed to do the same thing, such as the Relaxman, built by Synchrotech. Contronic Device Limited has put out a similar but superior machine called D.A.V.I.D.Jr. It can place a person into a deep delta wave sleep. These are just what are available to the public. Imagine what NASA, the NSA, and CIA have. If one needs to work with more than one person, the Synchro Energizer, $60,000, also built by Synchrotech, will place 32 people at the same time into altered states of consciousness. This machine uses full-spectrum lights to change the brain's state of consciousness. The Lumitron machine uses strobe lights that can be set to 11 different frequencies. When the light is directed through the retina, it is converted to an electrical nerve impulse called a photocurrent. Eventually, the photocurrent passes throughout the entire brain. Genesis is a machine which measures the brain's responses and then matches music to that response. Hospitals and corporations have been purchasing Genesis machines. The Twilight Learning device is a biofeedback machine that has an EEG machine hooked up to 2 tape recorders. There are dozens of technical articles on a whole host of subjects relating to the implants. This is a vast subject that really needs its own book. For further study of the big subject of implants, the reader is directed for starts to the following articles. Scotland on Sunday, April 2, 1995, had an article about how US and Swedish scientists have pioneered a method to graft neurons to a computer chip. Stanford University CA helped with this. A person can now be hotwired to a computer, such as Arnold Schwarzenegger in the film Total Recall. LA Times, August 17, 1994, article about the Hughes identification device, which is a tracking implant, microchip, which is called smart device. 6 million per year are planned to be quietly inserted into people during surgery. In a recent article, Alien Human Interactions, The Facts and Propaganda by Carla Turner, she points out that many alien abductees, like herself, are monitored and harassed by human agents of some sort, and the cases of phone and mail surveillance are only part of the story. He was compelled by some post-hypnotic suggestion. There is strong external evidence that these events have been carried out by strictly human agents and not by aliens giving the illusion of a military presence. She goes on to explain about the implants, wires and tubes that are put in victims of alien abductions. Carla Turner doesn't know that she is a victim of trauma-based mind control, but she's getting close to understanding what she has been subjected to. The Journal, Alexandria, Virginia, November 8, 1995, carried a story. Surgeon, a UFO buff operated and found. The story was by Steve Chalkins of the Scripps Howard News Service. The article talks about a Ventura, CA surgeon who has removed implants from abduction victims. The implanted items that are removed from victims disappear when sent in for tests to determine what they are. Relevance Magazine, on Behavioral Mod. Implants, 40 Times No. 83, October-Nov. 95 article on Russia's mind control called PIES. Barry Carr Center for Scientific Investigation of Claims of the Paranormal states, "We haven't heard of anything that, without the shadow of a doubt, couldn't have been made here on Earth. Let's see the evidence. It is clear that some people are now realizing that these implants are being placed into people by human slave owners, who simply are hypnotically telling their slaves that they are aliens. IBM began work on the implantable microchips under the cover of other goals. In the 1960s, GE took over the development. Honeywell continued the work after they merged. The R2E division of the CI2 Honeywell Bull in France has then gone on to develop the smart card. Lithium batteries in implants were secretly being used in the 1960s long before the public got wind. Fairchild has publicly announced several years ago that they have a biochip the size of a human hair with 4 times the capacity of the BT952000 project. These are some of the companies who have provided the network with a large assortment of implantable chips. In summary, electroshock is used to control a slave and to erase memory. Stun guns are used daily on some slaves. Slaves are under so much control that they will shock themselves if the master wants them to. Equipment has been developed to alter states of consciousness electronically, and also to track and monitor slaves. The most serious development in electronics for mind control is their ability with high-tech equipment to actually place thoughts into a person's mind. Harmonic machines, given code names, are now being used to do lots of the programming. Powerful individual and mass mind control can take place via electronic means. Our question, who will control the controllers of these electronic means? So far the American and European people have been content to let them get by with what they have done. Note, as aforementioned, here follows the author's technical description of a listening device relocated at the end of this podcast. 12. Hearing device. Detailed description of the preferred embodiment. This invention is based upon observations at the physical mechanism the mammalian brain uses to perceive acoustic vibrations. This observation is based in part upon neuroanatomical and other experimental evidence which relates to microwave brain stimulation and the perception of sounds. It has been observed that monochromatic acoustic stimuli, acoustic tones, or single tones, of different frequencies uniquely stimulate different regions at the cochlea. It has also been observed that there is a corresponding one-to-one relationship between the frequency of a monochromatic acoustic stimulus and the region of the auditory cortex neurally stimulated by the cochlear nerve under the physiologically normal conditions tonotopicity. It has been observed that for an acoustic tone of a frequency which is at the lower end at the entire acoustical range perceivable by a person, that thin lateral region, line, parallel to the medial axis of the brain and toward the infantor portion of the primary auditory cortex is stimulated. For an acoustic tone whose frequency is toward the high end of the entire perceivable acoustic range, a thin lateral region parallel to the medial axis and toward the superior portion at the primary auditory cortex is stimulated. Neural stimulation results in the generation at a broad band of microwave photons by the change in rotational energy state of protons integral to the neuron membrane of the auditory cortex. The physical size and shape of the brain and skull cavity, together with the semiconductor properties, conductivity and dielectric constant, of the brain tissue provide an electromagnetic resonant cavity. Specific single frequencies are constructively reinforced so that a number of standing electromagnetic waves, each at its own single electromagnetic frequency in the microwave frequency region, are generated in the brain. Each such standing electromagnetic wave is called a characteristic mode of the brain and skull cavity. Analysis in terms of prolate spheroidal wave functions indicates that transverse electric field components of these modes have maxima in the region of the auditory cortex. This analysis further shows that transverse electric field possess a variation of amplitude with angle in the angular plane, along the vertical dimension of the auditory cortex, and that is dependent only upon the primary mode number. The auditory cortex in the normally functioning mammalian brain is a source of microwave modes. The auditory cortex generates these modes in accordance with the neural stimulation of the auditory cortex by the cochlear nerve. Mode weighting for any one acoustic tone stimulus is given by the amplitude of each mode along the line region of the auditory cortex, which is neurally stimulated by that acoustic tone stimulus. A listing of mode weighting versus frequency of acoustic stimulus is called the mode matrix. In this invention, the functions of the ear, the cochlear nerve, and the auditory cortex are simulated. Microwaves simulating the mode matrix are inserted directly into the region of the auditory cortex. By this insertion of simulated microwave modes, the normal operation of the entire natural hearing mechanism is simulated. Referring now to Figure 1 and Figure 2, there is shown an apparatus which provides for induced perception of sound into a mammalian brain. This bearing device includes a microphone which receives sounds, an acoustic filter bank which separates the signals from the microphone into component frequencies, and a mode control matrix which generates the mode signals which are used to control the intensity of microwave radiations which are injected into the skull cavity in the region of the auditory cortex. The acoustic filter bank consists of a bank of acoustic filters FL through FK which span the audible acoustic spectrum. These filters may be built from standard resistance, inductance, and capacitance components in accordance with well-established practice. In the preferred embodiment, there are 24 filters which correspond to the observed critical bandwidths of the human ear. In this preferred embodiment, a typical list at filter parameters is given by table I to the right. Unfortunately, the writing is not very clear. The rectifier outputs 1 through K are feed to K mode partition devices. The mode partitioning devices each have n outputs, wherein n is the number of microwave oscillators used to generate the microwave radiation. The outputs 1 through n of each mode partition device is applied respectively to the inputs of each gain-controlled amplifier of the microwave radiation generator. The function of the mode control matrix is the control of the microwave amplifiers in the microwave amplifier bank. In the preferred embodiment, thus will be 24 outputs and 24 microwave frequency oscillators. Connected to each microwave amplifier gain control line is a mode simulation device which receives weighted mode signals from the mode partition devices. Each mode simulation device consists of 1 through K lines and diodes which are each connected to summing junction. The diodes provide for isolation from one mode partition device to the next. The diodes prevent signals from one mode partition device from returning to the other mode partition devices which are also connected to the same summing junction of the mode summation device. The diodes also serve a second function which is the rectification of the signals received from the acoustic filter bank by way of the mode partition devices. In this way, each mode partition device output is rectified to produce a varying DC voltage with major frequency components of the order of 15 milliseconds or less. The voltage at the summation junction is thus a slowly varying DC voltage. The example mode partition devices are shown in greater detail in figures 3, 4, and 5. The mode partition devices are merely resistance networks which produce 1 through N output voltages which are predetermined divisions of the input original from the acoustic filter associated with the mode partition device. Figure 3 shows a mode partitioning device wherein several outputs are associated with each series resistor. In the embodiment depicted in Figure 4, there is an output associated with each series resistor only, and thus there are n series resistors, or the same number of series resistors as there are outputs. The values of the resistors in the mode partition resistor network are determined in accordance with the magnitudes of the frequency component from the acoustic filter bank, which is required at the summation point or the gain control line for amplifiers. The microwave amplifier bank consists of plurality of microwave oscillators 1 through n, each of which is connected to an amplifier. Since the amplifiers are gain controlled by the signals at summation junction, the magnitude of the microwave output is controlled by the mode control matrix outputs Florida through F. In the preferred embodiment there are 24 amplifiers. The leads from the microwave oscillators I through N to the amplifiers are shielded to prevent crosstalk from one oscillator to the next, and to prevent stray signals from reaching the user of the hearing device. The output impedance of amplifiers should be 1000 ohms, and this is indicated by resistor. The outputs of amplifiers are all connected to a summing junction. The summing junction is connected to a summing impedance which is approximately 50 ohms. The relatively high amplifier output impedance as compared to the relatively low summing impedance provides minimization of crosstalk between the amplifiers. Since the amplitude of the microwave signal needed at the antenna is relatively small, there is no need to match the antenna and summing junction impedances to the amplifier output impedances. Efficiency of the amplifiers is not critical. Level control of the signal at antenna is controlled by pick-off, which is connected to the summing impedance. In this manner the signal at antenna can be varied from zero, ground, to a value which is acceptable to the individual. The antenna 24 is placed next to the subject's head and in the region of the subject's auditory cortex. By placement of the antenna in the region of the auditory cortex, the microwave field which is generated simulates the microwave field which would be generated if the acoustic sounds were perceived with normal hearing and the auditory cortex was functioning normally. In Figure 2a there is shown a second embodiment of the microwave radiation and generator portion of the hearing device. In this embodiment a broadband microwave source generates microwave signals which are fed to filters through which select from the broadband radiation particular frequencies to be transmitted to the person. As in Figure 2, the amplifiers receive signals on lines from the mode control matrix. The signals on lines provide the gain control for amplifiers. In Figure 6 there is shown a modified microwave hearing generator which includes a mode partition resistor divider network as depicted in Figure 5. Each of the mode partition voltage divider networks in this embodiment are individually adjustable for all of the resistances in the resistance network. Figure 5 depicts a voltage division system wherein adjustment of the voltage partition resistors is provided for. In Figure 6, the sound source generates audible sounds which are received by the microphone of the microwave hearing generator. In accordance with the operation described with respect to figures 1 and 2, microwave signals are generated at the antenna 10 in accordance with the redistribution provided by the mode control matrix as set forth in figure 5. The sound source also produces a signal on line 6 to 4 which is received by a headphone. The apparatus depicted in Fig. 6 is used to calibrate or fit a microwave hearing generator to a particular individual. Once the hearing generator is adjusted to the particular individual by adjustment of the variable resistors in the adjustable mode partition portion of the hearing generator, a second generator may be built using fixed value resistors in accordance with the adjusted values achieved in fitting the device to the particular subject. The sound produced by headphone should be the same as a sound from the sound source which is received by the microphone in the microwave hearing generator. In this way, the subject can make comparisons between the perceived sound from the hearing generator, and the sound which is heard from headphone. Sound source also produces a signal on which is fed in cue light. Cue light comes on whenever a sound is emitted from sound source to the microwave generator. In Figure 7 there is shown a modified microwave generator which may be used to determine a subject's microwave mode frequencies. In this device the acoustic filter bank and the mode control matrix have been removed and replaced by voltage level signals generated by potentiometers. Also included are a plurality of variable frequency oscillators which feed microwave amplifiers which are gain controlled from the signal generated by potentiometers and pick-off arm. This modified microwave hearing generator is used to provide signals using one oscillator at a TIMI. When an oscillator is turned on, the frequency is varied about the estimated value until a maximum acoustic perception by the subject is perceived. This perception, however, may consist of a buzzing or hissing sound tat rather than a tone, because only one microwave frequency is being received. The first test of perception is to determine the subject's lowest modal frequency for audibility. M equals 1. Once this modal frequency is obtained, the process is repeated for several higher modal frequencies and continued until no maximum acoustic perception occurs. Another method of determination of a subject's modal frequencies is through anatomical estimation. This procedure is by measurement of the subject's cephalic index and the lateral dimensions of the skull. In this method, the shape is determined in prolate spheroidal coordinates. Purely anatomical estimation of subject's modal frequencies is performed by first measuring the maximum lateral dimension, breadth, L figure 1, of the subject's head together with the maximum dimension D, anterior to posterior, in the medial plane of the subject's head. D is the distance along Z-axis as shown in figure 10. The ratio L/D, called in anthropology the cephalic index, is monotonically related to the boundary value E0 defining the ellipsoidal surface approximating the interface between the brain and the skull in the prolate spheroidal coordinate system. E0 defines the shape of this interface. E0 and D together give an estimate of A, the semifocal distance of the defining ellipsoid. Using E0 and A, together with known values of the conductivity and dielectric constants of brain tissue, those wavelengths are found for which the radial component of the electric field satisfies the boundary condition that it is zero at E0. These wavelengths are the wavelengths associated with the standing waves or modes. The corresponding frequencies are found by dividing the phase velocity of microwaves in brain tissue by each of the wavelengths. A subject's microwave modal frequencies may also be determined by observing the effect of external microwave radiation upon the EEG. The frequency of the M equal I mode may then be used as a base point to estimate all other modal frequencies. A typical example of such an estimation is where the subject is laterally irradiated with a monochromatic microwave field simultaneous with EEG measurement and the microwave frequency altered until a significant change occurs in the EEG. The lowest such frequency causing a significant EEG change is found. This is identified as the frequency of the M equals 1 mode, the lowest mode of importance in auditory perception. The purely anatomical estimation procedure, figures 8, 9, 10, is then performed and the ratio of each modal frequency to the M1 modal frequency obtained. These ratios together with the experimentally determined M, I frequency are then used to estimate the frequencies of the mode numbers higher than 1. The prolate spheroidal coordinate system is shown in figure 9. Along the lateral plane containing the x and y coordinates of figure 9. The prolate spheroidal coordinate variable 4, angle, lies. Figures 9 and 10. Plots of the transverse electric field amplitude versus primary mode number m are shown in figure 11. The equation is, the elevation view figure 12, of the brain from the left side, shows the primary auditory cortex. 10. The isotone lines and the high frequency region are toward the top of 100 and the low frequency region toward the bottom of 100. The formula I, set forth below, is the formula for combining modes from an isotone line at O equals OJ being excited to obtain the total modal field at some other angular location O. For this formula, if we let J equals 1, just one isotone single frequency acoustic stimulus line, then it can be shown that all modes, in general, must be used for any one tone. Figure 13 shows the resulting total modal field versus angle O for source location O at 5.25 degrees, 12.5 degrees, etc. With reference to the set of curves at the left top of this figure, a spacing of approximately 7.25 degrees in O corresponds to a tonal difference of about I octave. This conclusion is based on the side lobes of pattern coming from O equals 5.25 degrees, etc. The total filed value on y-axis falls considerably below the top curves for source locations well below 5.25 degrees, toward the high acoustic stimulus end, and also as the source of frequency goes well above 10 degrees frequency and, O is plotted positive downward from the, at lateral location as indicates in Fig. I 11. Resistor weightings are obtained from the, unreadable word. Formula I. The scale between acoustic frequency and O must be set or estimated from experiment. Approximately 5.25 plus or minus 1 degree corresponds to a tonal stimulus at about 2 kHz, the most sensitive region of the ear, since this source location gives the highest electric field amplitude. The apparatus of figure May 7th also be used to determine values for a hearing device which are required for a particular subject. Once the modal frequencies have been estimated, the device of figure 7 which includes variable microwave oscillators may be used to determine values for the oscillators which match the subject. And to determine resistance values associated with the mode partition devices of the mode control matrix. In figure 7 manual control of the amplifier gain is achieved by potentiometers 76. In this manner the amplifier gains are varied about the estimated settings ROR and acoustic tone stimulus in the region of 2000 Hz, 2 kHz, until maximum acoustic perception and a purest tone are achieved together. The term purest tone may also be described as the most pleasing acoustic perception by the subject. This process may be repeated at selected dot frequencies above and below 2 kHz. The selected frequencies correspond to regions of other acoustic filter center frequencies of the subject. When modal frequency, oscillator frequency, and gain set values, setting a potentiometer 76, are noted, it is then possible to calculate fixed oscillator frequencies and control resistor values for the adjusted hearing device for this particular subject. In the event the subject has no prior acoustic experience, namely deaf from birth, estimated resistor values must be used. Also, a complex acoustic stimulation test including language articulation and pairs of harmonically related tones may be developed to maximize the match of the hearing device parameters for those of this particular subject. Typical components for use in this invention include commercially available high-fidelity microphones which have a range of 50 Hz to 5 kHz with plus or minus 3 dB variation. The audio filters to be used with the acoustic filter bank 12 are constructed in a conventional manner, and have Q values of about 6. The filters may also be designed with 3 dB down points, half the bandwidth away from the center frequency, occurring at adjacent center frequency locations. The diode 17 in the mode control matrix which provide isolation between the mode partition circuits are commercially available diodes in the audio range. The microwave oscillators I through N and the microwave amplifiers 20 are constructed with available microwave transistors which can be configured either as oscillators or amplifiers. Examples of the transistors are GASFET field effect transistors by Hewlett-Packard known as the HFET series or silicon bipolar transistors by Hewlett-Packard known as the HXTR series. All the cable between the oscillators, the microwave amplifiers, and the antenna should be constructed with either single or double shielded coaxial cable. The antenna 24 for directing microwave signals to the audio cortex 26 should be approximately the size of the auditory cortex. A typical size would be 1.5 cm high and 0.5 to 1 cm wide. The antenna as shown is located over the left auditory cortex. But the right may also be used. Since the characteristic impedance of the brain tissue at these microwave frequencies is close to 50 ohms, efficient transmission by commercially available standard 30 ohm coax is possible. The invention has been described in reference to the preferred embodiments. It is, however, to be understood that other advantages, features, and embodiments may be within the scope of this invention as defined in the appended claims. What is claimed is 1. A sound perception device for providing induced perception of sound into a mammalian brain comprising in combination, means for generating microwave radiation which is representative of a sound to be perceived, said means for generating including means for generating a simultaneous plurality of microwave radiation frequencies and means for adjusting the amplitude of said microwave radiation frequencies in accordance with the sound to be perceived, an antenna means located in the region of the auditory cortex of said mammalian brain for transmitting said microwave energy into the auditory cortex region of said brain. 2. A hearing device for perception of sounds comprising in combination, means for generating a signal representative of sounds, means for analyzing said signal representative of said sounds having an output, means for generating a plurality of microwave signals having different frequencies having an input connected to said output of said means for analyzing said signals, having an output, means for applying said plurality of microwave signals to the head of a subject, and whereby the subject perceives sounds which are representative of said sounds. 3. The apparatus in accordance with claim 2 wherein said means for generating a signal is a microphone for detecting sound waves. 4. The apparatus in accordance with claim 2 wherein said means for applying said plurality of microwave signals is an antenna. 5. The apparatus in accordance with claim 4 wherein said antenna is placed in the region of the auditory cortex of the subject. 6. The apparatus in accordance with claim 2 wherein the subject is a human being. 7. The apparatus in accordance with claim 2 wherein said means for analyzing said signal comprises an acoustic filter bank for dividing said sounds into a plurality of component frequencies, and a mode control matrix means for providing control signals which are weighted in accordance with said plurality of component frequencies, having an output connected to said means for generating a plurality of microwave signal inputs. 8. The apparatus in accordance with claim 7 wherein said acoustic filter bank includes a plurality of audio frequency filters. 9. The apparatus in accordance with claim 8 wherein said audio frequency filters provide a plurality of output frequencies having amplitudes which are a function of said signal representative of sounds. 10. The apparatus in accordance with claim 9 wherein said amplitudes are the weighted in accordance with transform function of the signal representative of sounds. 11. The apparatus in accordance with claim 7 wherein said mode control matrix device includes a voltage divider connected to each of said plurality of said audio frequency filters. 12. The apparatus in accordance with claim 11 wherein each of said voltage dividers has a plurality of outputs which are connected in circuit to said means for generating a plurality of microwave signals. 13. The apparatus in accordance with claim 2 wherein said means for generating a plurality of mirror wave signals comprises a plurality of microwave generators each having a different frequency and means for controlling the output amplitude of each of said generators. 14. The apparatus in accordance with claims 2 wherein said means for generating plurality of microwave signals comprises a broadband microwave source and a plurality of filters. 15. The apparatus in accordance with claim 13 wherein said generators each comprise a microwave signal source and a gain-controlled microwave amplifier. 16. The apparatus in accordance with claim 13 wherein said means for analyzing output is connected to said means for controlling microwave amplifier output amplitudes. 17. The apparatus in accordance with claim 13 wherein analyzing includes K audio frequency filters. 18. The apparatus in accordance with claim 17 wherein there are N microwave generator. 19. The apparatus in accordance with claim 18 including a mode partitioning means which provides N outputs for each of said K audio frequency filters. 20. The apparatus in accordance with claim 19 wherein said N amplifiers each have K inputs from said mode partitioning means. 21. The apparatus in accordance with claim 20 wherein said N amplifiers have K inputs less the mode partitioning means outputs which are so small that they may be omitted. 22. The apparatus in accordance with claim 20 wherein said mode partitioning output device outputs each include a diode connected to each microwave amplifier gain control to provide isolation between all outputs. 23. The apparatus in accordance with claim 20 wherein said K audio frequency filters are chosen to correspond to the critical bandwidths of the human ear. 24. The apparatus in accordance with claim 20 wherein said N microwave generators are each adjustable in frequency output. 25. The apparatus in accordance with claim 18 wherein the frequency of each N microwave generators is determined by anatomical estimation. 26. The apparatus in accordance with claim 18 wherein the frequency of the lowest frequency microwave generator is chosen by determination of the effect of external microwave generation on the EEG of the subject. 27. The apparatus in accordance with claim 18 wherein the frequency of each of said N microwave generators corresponds to the subject's microwave modal frequencies. 28. The apparatus in accordance with claim 27, wherein the subject's modal frequencies are determined by measurement of the subject's cephalic index and the lateral dimensions of the skull. 29. The apparatus in accordance with claim 28, wherein the subject's lowest modal frequency is determined high varying the frequency of the lowest frequency microwave generator about the estimated vol 2 until a maximum acoustic perception is obtained by the subject.